Thank you. Welcome to the talk about understanding RegEx using deep learning. I am Shubhadeep Roychowdhury. Just to give you a little bit of background, who am I? So I'm a developer and machine learning engineer for about 16 years now. I was born and brought up in India. I did physics and computer science there, master degree. I created my first company out of my master degree in computer science. It was a game development company, perhaps the first one in India, with three other friends of mine. We did it for 4 years, then we moved on. I worked in startups both in India and Europe. Technically led few successful products in several domains such as business intelligence and brand performance measurement and these kind of things. I'm in Paris since last end of 2016, worked here in two different startups, and then finally 6 months ago I created my second company. It's called Codist AI, where we are trying to use artificial intelligence, machine learning, and programming language theory to help developers navigate and understand source code faster than what is possible to. And I play the role of CTO there. The structure of this talk will be divided in four sections. The first one is motivation, where I will talk about why I chose this problem and how did I think about it. Then the second one, I will discuss a little bit about the technique or the model I used, about the framework I used, and all these, and about the infrastructure and logistics as well. Third, I will present some results, mainly qualitative, to show exactly what kind of prediction the model was giving and what was the gold standard. And at the end, there will be time for questions. So let's begin. There is one other slide here. I present some resources. Basically, there is one paper where it was originally my first inspiration, but the paper was solving the exact opposite problem. So basically, given a natural language description, emit a regex out of it. So what kind of regex it should happen from that natural language description. But I solved the problem just opposite of it. Given a regex, emit the intent in natural language. Also, there is a general introduction to neural machine translation. The original source of the data that I used. And we have open sourced the entire code via a Google collaboratory notebook. The link is also there. And there is a Medium article that we wrote about it after we open sourced it. You can also get it in this slide. So if the slides are shared, you can get them. Otherwise, if you are interested, I can make them available to you as well. So, just to give a basic background of regular expression, I think it's pretty known to any developer out there. It was originally proposed and formalized around 1950s, and it's a kind of a regular language according to formal language theory. So the grammar has expressive power of a regular grammar. It was around late 1960s when Ken Thompson first introduced regular expression in QED, which is an editor that he was developing for an early version of IBM computer. That's when it started to become very popular. And today it's quite popular. There are two different versions of it. One is POSIX and one is PARL. The versions that we mainly use are basically PARL flavor. The only big problem with regular expression is that if you encounter a regular expression, that happened to me a lot of times actually, when I see a code somebody else before me had written the code and they used a regular expression to search a particular string within a string. I always ask myself, and if I can get to that person also, why? I mean, very often I find it's very hard to read and understand a regular expression just out of the box, just like that. So it's hard to get the intent, to be very frank. If you are trying to generate a particular regular expression based on an idea that you have, a particular search that you want to perform, you can get help in Stackoverflow and these kind of things. But if you have a regular expression and you want to know the intent of it and there is no comment or anything such that, then the problem is bigger, because then either you have to post a question directly in Stack Overflow and wait for somebody to answer, or use some other tools. And I will give pointers to some other tools that solve this same problem, but in a different way. So given all this, I thought about this particular problem, and I also read the paper, so I thought about this particular problem and I thought, okay, let's try to see if there is a way to solve this. So I tried to look for existing tools which solves the exact same thing that I was doing, and there are two that I came across, maybe there are more that I don't know about, but these two are quite good. They solve the exact same thing. Basically, you can get the intent of a regular expression when copy paste a regular expression there. The thing is that they were implemented, the rules are handwritten for those tools, and it's huge and tedious programs that you have to write to generate the intent of a regular expression just based on finite state automata. So that at that point, I asked myself this question: that can we train an end-to-end differentiable model, which is a neural net, to do the same job without any prior domain knowledge? Is it possible or not? And from that point, I started to think. I started to read. I worked on this problem maybe just like 2 weeks at one point of time. And at the end of the second week, I achieved the result that I'm going to present today. So the way I formulated this problem is a sequence-to-sequence problem, like neural machine translation, basically. I will try to give an idea, a basic idea of sequence-to-sequence problem, now. So in a sequence-to-sequence problem, you have a sequence from a source language, such as French, English, or whatever. It's basically a sequence of tokens. And then the task is to produce the translation of same sequence of tokens in a target language. So this is the classic example. In French, it says le chat est noir. And you pass it through an encoder, you generate a context, and then you pass it through a decoder and get the catches back. So you train the network for several epochs, and at one point, this kind of result will be achieved. And a lot of advancement has been made into this particular domain recently. We probably know about transformers, then BART, then there was ELMO, a lot of new models that came up, and they are doing extremely well in many language generation, language modeling, sequence-to-sequence tasks. So basically, when I started to work on this problem, I thought about four different types of models that I new and I thought that could be applicable. One is the classic encoder-decoder architecture that I just showed here in the picture. Then I thought about also having an encoder-decoder architecture but with an attention mechanism at the decoder layer. And then there was transformer style architecture where there is no really LSTM or no memory cell, just attention layer. And then also I came across another very interesting paper while trying to solve this problem. It's called CopyNet. And I will present an idea about CopyNet, where it could have been made my result better at the end when I will discuss the result. The idea behind CopyNet is simple. It's just it tried to train the network to copy a particular part of the input sequence as it is in the output sequence. So for an example, let's say you are trying to generate a one-line description of a function, of a code. So if you take this and also as a sequence-to-sequence problem that you put in the code from one side as a sequence and get the natural language one-line comment on the other side as another sequence in the target. In that case, it's often the case as a developer that when you write a function, a comment of a function, you also use the name inside the comment somewhere. So CopyNet, for example, will probably learn that to use this kind of copy from the sequence, from the input sequence to the output sequence. So these are the four different type of models that I considered using while trying to solve this problem. And finally, the one that I experimented with was encoder-decoder with an attention layer, the decoding stack. I'm pretty sure that all the other different architectures such as transformer or BERT-like architectures could have been used. The only issue in that case is that my dataset was very small. It was about 10,000 to 12,000 pair of sequences. So with that small of a dataset, if I use a huge model with millions of parameters, it will very easily overfit. So that's why I stayed to a relatively smaller model, and now the data. So there is a link to the original paper that I already mentioned, where the task was to solve the exact opposite problem. So I took the same data from them. They had like a synthetic data set of about 10,000 to 12,000 pairs. And the cleaning of the data or the pre-processing of the data was largely following the steps described in the paper. So basically, the first step is to remove any words and replace them with symbols such as M0, M1. So for an example, let's say you have a string, the sky is blue, and then you have the corresponding intent and the corresponding regex. And in that case, both the word the sky will be inside the regex expression and also in the natural language sentence. So the idea was to take the word sky and replace it with a symbol like M0. In my opinion, what I understood from the intention of those people or those researchers who wrote the paper is that it was just to present anonymization in the data. So it was not super useful, but I still kept it as it is because I followed the basic steps from the paper. So again, so that means basically wherever the word sky will come, it will be always represented by M0, basically. Then replacing classic regex things such as A to Z or small a to Z by caps, or by the word caps, or by the word small, or things like that. Then you make it everything, we make it everything lowercase. Then we tokenize it, we binarize it, and we create a batch-based reader. So for the last three steps, the library that I used to do the work is called LNNLP. It's an NLP library based on PyTorch. It's pretty good, and there is a lot of model that is already present that you can fine-tune practically the models. Even for example, There was even also a copynet implementation that they gave out of the box in the library itself. So it was interesting and easier to use a library like that. So for the last three steps, I used basically an NLP, and the first three steps were pure normal code, no particular library. So this is the model that I used. It's a simple sequence to sequence model with an embedding layer that embeds the source tokens. Then we have a three-layer LSTM stacked LSTM with a dropout of 0.25. Then there is an attention layer for the decoder, which is a classic multiplicative attention layer with a 10H activation function. And at the end, for the decoder, is a single layer LSTM with at the output layer, it's a projection layer of a linear projection layer. So I actually tried to experiment with a little bit with all the hyperparameters here. So far, what with my first iteration that I am presenting here, basically, these are the hyperparameters that worked best for me. I tried to increase the dropout. It did not really increase much the performance. And when I was increasing the number of layers or things like that, it was kind of overfitting. So I kept it to this particular set of hyperparameters, but probably there are more other set of hyperparameters that will solve the same exact problem. So here is a description of the training, what I did. So there is a concept in an NLP library where you can actually ask the trainer to train for a certain number of epochs with a patience, which means that if you give a validation set, and it's kind of mandatory that you have to give a validation set to use a model, to use something from an NLP, they are kind of strict about this. So if you give a validation set, what it will do is that it will start training your model and keeping a tab about your validation loss. And once your validation loss did not improve for those number of epochs which you gave as patients, it will automatically stop the model and give you the last best model that was available. So in our case, what we did is that we scheduled the model to be trained for 100 epochs, which is a huge amount of epochs given the amount of data we had. So we were pretty sure that it won't go that long. But what we were surprised to discover is that with a patience of 10, our training stopped at 32 epochs. So basically, we reached the best model by 23rd epoch, and then it did not, the validation loss did not improve. So it just stopped by itself, and we used the model from 23rd epoch. Without any other special tricks, with only those deprocessing steps that I mentioned before, the model reached about 80% accuracy for the training set, and quite close for the validation set as well. About the logistics, we used AWS Deep Learning AMI to host the code and the data. It was pretty easy to do that. And then, as a fun experiment also, after we finished training the model, what we did is that we created a small web app where we are surfing the model. So we let people play with it a little bit to see, to have fun, basically. Because on one hand, I will show some examples. In one hand, the model was interesting, and on the other hand, there was some dumb stuff that was happening. So it was funny and interesting at the same point of time. So we created a web app, and we let people play with the model via the web app, and it was quite a nice learning to to do this part as well. But this is not the subject of my talk today. Anyway, so now about the result. As I said, the results will be more qualitative. The result I'm showing you. So I picked up three examples from predictions. One, what I believe is a bad prediction. One, what is the prediction and the gold standard is very close, almost same. And one, where I believe the prediction is actually a bit better than the gold standard itself. So the bad prediction was that the interesting thing about the bad prediction is that the original, the gold standard was that the lines which is with the string M0 followed by a capital letter and six or more times in them. The problem that the model suffered, and it's kind of a general observation I saw in many cases this happened, is that whenever there was some digit like 6, 7, 2, 3, whatever, in the gold standard, the model emitted a digit also, but the digit did not match. So for example, in gold standard there was 6 or more letters, but the model replaced it with 2. I have no idea why it was happening, but it's quite common. I saw this in many cases in the product prediction. And this is one example, I believe, one of the areas where probably CopyNet could have been given a better result, because most likely it would have understood to or learned to copy the digits as it is from the source to the target. Then there is the same prediction, which is basically the gold standard was lines with word ending with number before lowercase letter, and the prediction was exactly similar, lines with words ending with a number before lowercase letter. Then there is the better prediction part. It's according to my judgment, I believe that this prediction from a point of view of understanding, this prediction is a bit better. So the gold was lines with the string M0 before a vowel and string M1. And the prediction was lines with the string M0 before a vowel and the string M1 at least once in them. This particular part, at least once, was very very apt, and it was rightly put, it was rightly done by the model. And that actually, in my opinion, makes this prediction better than the gold standard. So this result, as I said, was basically, I worked on this problem for like about a week and a half or 2 weeks mostly. And once we reached there, I enjoyed it. I learned a lot. And at that time, I thought about sharing my learning with everybody. I don't really regularly do machine learning models, but it was one of the nice exceptions, and I really enjoyed doing it. So that's one of the other reasons why I'm trying to present it in front of you, the enjoyment and the fun that I had to do this part. Now, if you have any questions. Thank you. Yes, please.
Hello.
Hello.
Good presentation. My question is regarding the learning rate you used. Did you happen to think about making a learning rate that reduces through AVOX and would maybe go into the solution little by little? Because I see that your learning rate is fixed.
Yeah. I did not use decay. I did not decay or did not change my learning rate basically. Yeah. I mean, as I said, this was my first attempt to solve this problem. I did not see, from whatever I tried to look for around the internet, I did not see anybody solving this exact problem. They solved the exact opposite problem, but this one that I tried to solve, I haven't seen any research to do that. My goal was not to do the research. My goal was to try to see that if it is actually possible to go from the other way around, as we already had the data set. And so it was something that I just wanted to try and see what it yields at the end. Yeah, I did not use learning rate decay. I could have used, that is true, but I did not. But there are thousands, many things I think one can improve in my approach to this. For example, if this synthetic data set can be bigger, maybe a bigger model can give a better result. I don't know. Okay, then thank you very much again for sharing the fun and the joy that I had, and hope to see you again in the next PyCon and the rest of the day. Have a good day. Thank you.